lead counsel for victims, Michael Jenkins and Eddie Parker. I'm here with co-counsel, Mississippi counsel Trent Walker. I'm here with Michael and Eddie's families. Okay, today, here in Rankin County Circuit Court, is a day that we've long awaited. This day, the Rankin County Goon Squad, Hunter Elward, Brett McAlpin, Christian Dedman, Opdyke, Middleton, and Deputy Hartsfield from Richland, they all had to come and appear in a courtroom where they have created much mischief in.
That's right.
For many, many years, the Goon Squad has come into this courtroom, and they have testified falsely against persons that they have beaten and caused to be wrongfully incarcerated. In this courtroom and in this courthouse, they have been given credibility to their statements and what they have presented to this court. But today was dramatically different. Today, the judge in this circuit county court has given out justice to the Rankin County Goon Squad and have brought them to justice in front of the world here today. In the same location where they have harmed many people, they were brought here in prison outfits, prison uniforms, and they're all headed to jail for a long time.
That's right, man.
You all know that the federal prison sentences are lengthy. Christian Dedman, 40 years. Brett McAlpin, 27 years.
Right.
Hunter Elward, 20 years. Daniel Opdyke, 17 and a half years. Middleton, 17 and a half years. And Hartsfield, 10 years. Today, they did not receive any additional time to their federal sentences. What Judge Ratcliffe did do was he departed from the initial recommendations. Initial recommendations were very low in this case, and that would be indicative of the past. I think that Judge Ratcliffe departed from the recommendations, and doing so, he set a new standard here in Rankin County, that police brutality will not be tolerated in Rankin County. Let us be clear, no police officer in the history of Rankin County has ever been held criminally responsible for harming anyone, let alone a black person. No deputy in Rankin County has ever been given a single day of jail time in this courtroom. And so what happened in this courtroom today is significant. Yes, we would have preferred a couple of extra years. Yes, we would have preferred that a couple of more years of time were added on to the defendant's sentences. However, we respect the judgment of this court. We respect the wisdom of this court. And Mississippi has spoken here.
Yes, sir.
This is Mississippi.
Yes, sir.
This has never happened in Mississippi.
Yes, Mississippi.
Justice has come in Mississippi. What has come?
Justice.
And when has it come?
Now.
Justice has come when?
Now.
Okay, and so.
Listen.
Okay, so we wanted a couple more years, of sure, but we still understand that the 132 years of sentences and prison time that these defendants are facing for what they did to Michael Jenkins and Eddie Parker, that stands forever. There will be no turning back on those sentences. And these are the longest and strongest sentences in United States history for any police officers.
That's right.
These are the longest prison times ever for any group of police officers. Never have six police officers been sent to prison for this amount of time in America or in Mississippi.
Yes, sir.
Okay, we're coming. Brother Eddie, I guess I wanted to tell you how they're feeling. They didn't speak today. They've been undergoing a lot, but they want to explain how they feel. Just how they're feeling, because this has been traumatizing. And we want to hear what they have to say. Then we have some more important information about the supervisor of the Goon Squad, Brian Bailey.
Go ahead, Mike.
Okay.
It's been a long time coming, long year, hard work, a lot of dedication. And it really ain't been about me. It's been about what they did to my mom and how it made her feel. And just to dictating the bullying, you know what I'm saying? And that's why I wanted to get so bad, how they made her feel. I did it. She did it. We did it.
It's been a long year, man. But it's been a short year. I'm thankful for all y'all, you know, been here with us, man, for the ride. All y'all that helped us, you know, with this fight, man. I just want y'all to know, man, it touched me in my heart, man, to know that we were listened to. You know, y'all gave us a voice, man. Y'all gave us time, man. Y'all gave us strength, you know. So I appreciate all y'all. And today, Rankin County, you know, made a believer out of me. You know, made a believer out of hundreds. I know thousands, maybe millions of people. So I'm just thankful and you know that I'm here to see it, and I'm glad, you know, Michael here to see it with me. You know, appreciative of my lawyers, you know, fighting for us. I mean, couldn't do it without them. All our family, man, they've been riding with us. It's been it's been up and down, man, up and down. It's still up and down, man, you know. But still a roller coaster, man. We're gonna ride this thing out, man. Appreciate y'all.
We are steps away from the jail where the administrator, Brian Bailey, could be working right now. Is there a message that he should receive from what has happened here today?
We're going to take it over.
Brian Bailey should be on notice that he may be next. That he may be next in this courtroom. He may be next for federal prosecution. And certainly he is on the list for federal monitoring and takeover of his department. Brian Bailey is ultimately responsible for all of the actions of the Goon Squad because she should have been doing his job. He should have been monitoring his department. I'll let Attorney Trent Walker follow up on that, and then we want to hear from the family.
The fourth in command was in this array of people who were sentenced. What does that say about how high this went up in terms of this administration?
I think it says everything about how high it went up. You don't rise to position of fourth in command of the department without those who are above you, specifically the sheriff, knowing exactly how you operate. Some of the defendants specifically allocated at their federal sentencing about what was expected of them and the violence that was expected of them as members of this department, and specifically if they were going to work on that shift. So I would find it impossible, and it belies common sense to think that the sheriff had no idea of what had been occurring in his department for years. And also, I want to point out, he didn't start out as the sheriff. He served as a deputy in this department for probably the better part of 10 years. So he knew when he was rank and file how things operated, and he knew when he became the sheriff how things operated.
Trent, it's already been proven that there are other families that say they've been victims of this same Goon Squad. Do you think there have been people who stories have not been able to come out yet, who are still scared, who are still wanting to see action from the federal government?
I absolutely know that to be true. There have been people that we've spoken with, Mr. Shabazz and I, who have come forward, who have still been unwilling to want to undergo, the rigors of a lawsuit and having to testify and having to come public, but they've called our respective offices, so I absolutely know that to be true.
Trent, can you and Mr. Shabazz talk about how much lower the state's recommendations were for the state charges?
To my recollection, what the judge did here was probably double what the original recommendations were, so that with, I think, one exception, everybody got the max. Now, obviously, when you are plea bargaining, the negotiating back and forth is a part of it, but what everybody understands is that the judge does not have to accept a recommendation, and that as far back as August, all of these defendants indicated that they understood that the judge did not have to accept their recommendations. So given the gravity of what has gone on in this case, none of that should have been a shock to them.